Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fidel Castro, in his own words, by Alex Moore, narrated by Neil Hellegers. Introduction. It's difficult to imagine a more polarizing figure in the 20th and early 21st centuries than Fidel Castro. In reading and researching his life and political rise and growth, I have been able to find nearly as many evaluations, books, and articles that praise him as a hero as there are that proclaim he's the devil himself. Which is the true Fidel? I've come to the conclusion that really depends, and probably always will, on perception. On the one hand, Fidel was a hero. Since taking the reins in Cuba, he improved conditions for women and minorities and increased literacy, among other progressive advances. He helped in the fight against apartheid. He was revered by some world leaders, including Nelson Mandela, as a tireless humanitarian. On the other hand, he nationalized businesses, cut into profit margins, and socialized health care, which, from wherever you stand, is good or bad. He was reviled by some world leaders, including any American Republican president who's been in office since the Cuban Revolution in 1959. Did he exile the wealthy? Throw them out of the country and take away their lands and homes? It depends on whom you ask. Some will angrily stand true to this conviction until their dying breath. Others will say this wasn't the case, that the wealthy ran to the United States, where they waited in vain for the U.S. government to oust the cunning communist. From whichever side of the Fidel fence you sit, what remains undeniable is that Fidel Castro was a powerful man with powerful ideas, who devised a revolution and maintained control of a country for more than 5 decades. The illegitimate son of a wealthy landowner and the cook from the house that landowner had shared with his first family and wife, Fidel didn't grow up in poverty himself, but it surrounded him. Many kids from around the area would never finish high school, let alone grade school, because their families had no money. Fidel studied away from home with the Jesuits and went on to complete college and law school. Not much for classroom learning. He read everything from literature to law and public policy, and developed a deep, abiding passion for Marxism, which changed his life. He got involved in politics while still a student, and after graduating and setting up his own law practice, he began organizing and plotting against Fulgencio Batista, who had taken control of Cuba in a military coup. His first attempt failed. In training for his second attempt, he solidified an enduring friendship with Argentine revolutionary Ernesto Che Guevara. And together with Fidel's brother, Raul, they took back Cuba. In power, Fidel did things that were objectionable, like abolish the multi-party system and elections in general, nationalize business, and socialize reforms. He became an enemy to capitalists everywhere, even inspiring the United States to attack Cuba, with Cuban exiles, incidentally, in the early 1960s. In making friends with a communist superpower, he nearly had the power to end the world, or so was the perception during the Cuban Missile Crisis. While the economy of Cuba has ebbed and flowed, in large part due to the embargo imposed by the United States and the fall of the USSR, he remained at the helm for more than 5 decades. Love him or hate him, one can't deny the impact he had on the world for a half century. The primary focus of this book is to create a profile of Fidel Castro by painting with his own words. In other words, what comes through here is the history of Fidel, according to Fidel. History at large may be able to pinpoint the irony and the untruths in his words, but there's no denying the clarity, the focus, the conviction, and the passion of his thoughts. "History will absolve me," said Fidel in his famous speech, defending himself, during his trial for the attack on the Moncada barracks. Whether that will be true in everyone's interpretation of history, of course, remains to be seen. Alex Moore, October 2013. Chapter 1. Castro, the Bold Young Boy. November 6, 1940. Santiago de Cuba. Mr. Franklin Roosevelt, President of the United States. My good friend Roosevelt, I don't know very English, but I know as much as to write to you. I like to hear the radio, and I am very happy, because I heard in it that you will be president for a new periodo. I am 12 years old. I am a boy, but I think very much. But I do not think that I am writing to the President of the United States. If you like, give me a $10 bill, green American, in the letter, because never, I have not seen a $10 bill, green American, and I would like to have one of them. My address is Señor Fidel Castro, Colegio de Dolores, Santiago de Cuba, Oriente, Cuba. I don't know very English, but I know very much Spanish. And I suppose you don't know very Spanish, but you know very English, because you are American, but I am not American. Thank you very much. Goodbye, your friend. Signed, Fidel Castro. If you want iron to make your sheep's ships, I will show you the biggest minas of iron on the land. They're in Mayari, Oriente, Cuba. Fidel Castro was the third of his mother's seven children, born on August 13, 1926, on their farm in Biran, Cuba. His parents kept busy running the large family farm and bearing and raising his younger siblings. As a result, much of his young life was spent at boarding schools, where his parents paid others to look after him. Fidel's formal education began at the young age of four at the country school in Biran. His older brother and sister, Ramon and Angelita, attended the school and were instructed by a teacher who lived in Santiago and who had come to Biran to teach lessons and stay at the schoolhouse. Although he was only four, Fidel would join his older brother and sister when they went to school, and they gave him a desk right up front. 2 years later, when Fidel was six, his parents sent his sister Angelita to Santiago to live and study with their teacher, and young Fidel went along. Soon after, their brother Ramon came too, and all three children lived as boarders with the teacher's family. Fidel hated living with the teacher in Santiago. Her family was poor, and Fidel's life of freedom and plenty in Biran did not prepare him for the dirty, crowded, restrictive conditions in the small city. Fidel wasn't sent to school or given lessons, and spent his time idly about the house, or playing in the street with other young boys. And he was always hungry. In Biran, there was always enough to eat, but at the teacher's house, the meals were divided between the whole family. Fidel explained in a later interview, "Suddenly I discovered that rice was very tasty, and sometimes they'd serve the rice with a piece of sweet potato or some picadillo. I don't remember that there was ever any bread. But the problem was that the same little bit of food, for six or seven people, was supposed to last through lunch and dinner, the food that was sent in at lunch. The food came from the house of one of the teacher's cousins, whom they called Cosita, little bit or little thing. She was a very fat lady. I don't know why they called her Cosita. Apparently she was the one who ate all the food." Fidel and his siblings were delivered from this living situation one day when Lena arrived to visit her three eldest and found them remarkably malnourished. She brought them to a cafe to eat their fill of ice cream and mangoes, and then brought them back home to the farm in Biran. The next time the teacher returned to the little town, Fidel and his brother made a plan to get revenge. The two set up a fort of logs from across the schoolhouse and, using a slingshot, fired stones up and onto the galvanized zinc roof, making a huge racket. Fidel recalled the prank with pride. The rocks were landing on that zinc roof. By the time two or three were hitting the roof, There'd be two or three more in the air. We considered ourselves experts at that. This was Fidel's first real act of rebellion. A childish act of revenge against an authority whom he'd perceived mistreated him. As he continued with his schooling, he found plenty of other opportunities to raise his voice and his fists. After leaving the teacher's house, Fidel returned to Santiago to study at the Colegio de la Salle from the first through the fifth grades, boarding at the school's facilities and sharing a room with his brothers and a friend. Here there was plenty to eat, and Fidel enjoyed living at the school, especially when they could visit the facilities by the water, where he could swim and fish and play sports with the other boys. It wasn't long before Fidel clashed with his teachers. He fought with one in particular, Vice Principal Brother Bernardo, who was in charge of boarding students. Fidel had made a particular enemy of this vice principal, he said, by fighting with another student who happened to be one of Brother Bernardo's favorites. The vice principal slapped him for this hard. Later, he slapped Fidel again for speaking out of turn while waiting in line. The third and final time he raised his hand to Fidel was in the courtyard, while boys were getting ready to play a game. Fidel was scrabbling with his classmates, deciding who would be at bat first, when he felt the vice principal hit him on the side of the head. But that was the last time, because I just blew up. I was so furious that I took those buttered rolls from breakfast and threw them right in the vice principal's face as hard as I could. Then I ran at him and jumped on him like a little tiger, biting him, kicking him, hitting him with my fists, in front of the whole school. That was my second rebellion. I was a student, and he was a figure of authority who abused and humiliated a student. Needless to say, Fidel and his brothers soon left the Colegio de la Salle and were sent home again to the farm in Biran. As punishment for their bad behavior, the boys' parents decided they would not be sent to another school. This suited Fidel's brothers, but Fidel was angry. This was clearly another instance where his opinions and those of the authority figures clashed. And so Fidel rebelled again, this time threatening to burn his house down if his parents didn't send him to school. Fidel claimed his parents were impressed with his enthusiasm for learning, or, as Fidel put it, "My mother was always the peacemaker, my father very understanding. He may have liked how firm I was in defending my right to go to school. Whatever the case, my parents decided to send me off to school again." It is notable that in this retelling, Castro says he was defending his right. He frames his threat as an instance of standing against an authority to defend what is right, where another observer might say he was demanding he get his own way, and by threatening violence, no less. Even from a young age, Fidel Castro was a man unafraid to ask for what he wanted. As a result of Fidel's successful campaign to be sent back to school, he was soon enrolled at the Jesuit-run Colegio de Dolores in Santiago. Here, Fidel got along with his teachers. The Jesuits, it seems, knew what to do with a spirited young boy. Fidel said of them later, "They know how to form boys' characters. If you do risky, difficult things, engage in that sort of activities, they see that as proof of an enterprising, determined character, a get-up-and-go sort of character. They don't discourage it." As a Jesuit school well known for its high educational standards, the Colegio de Dolores was a popular school for wealthy students like Fidel. It was here that Fidel began to learn English and penned his letter to President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He spoke of the letter casually many years after the fact, explaining that he wrote it while they were learning English from a textbook. "After the triumph of the revolution, the Americans found my letter and published it, thanks to which I have a copy of it, because I didn't keep one. And there are people who have told me that if Roosevelt had only sent me $10, I wouldn't have given the United States so many headaches." Castro didn't offer much other information about this strange moment in time, although he did say he got a response and that they hung a copy on the bulletin board. But the letter gives an interesting view of a young man who had learned to speak up early in life, and who was unafraid of directly addressing authority. Chapter 2. Learning to Rebel. I was the son of a landowner, not the grandson. If I'd been the grandson of a rich family, I'd have been born. I'd have an aristocratic birth, and all my friends and all my culture would have been marked by a sense of superiority over other people. But in fact, where I was born, everybody was poor. My own family on my mother's side was poor, and my father's family in Galicia was also very poor. When one thinks of Fidel Castro rising up to overthrow the tyranny of capitalism, one might imagine that he grew up at the butt end of the economic system, that it crushed his family and his young spirit enough that rebelling against it was all he could do. However, it's interesting to note that Fidel Castro did not grow up in poverty, or anything close to it. Yet the concept of the injustice of poverty, coupled with an innate rebellious streak, were what would eventually propel Fidel to act against a system that had some having more at the expense of others. Fidel had a rebellious streak, and one could surmise it was in his blood. Fidel's father, Angel Castro, hadn't always necessarily played by the rules himself. The elder Castro hailed from Galicia, Spain. In 1895, at age 17, he signed up with the Spanish colonial army, apparently paid by a wealthy landowner to take the landowner's place in the army. Nearing the end of the 19th century, Spain's once vast stake in North America had dwindled down to Puerto Rico and Cuba. While the Cuban independence movement began in the 1880s, it was not until around the point that Angel had joined the Spanish army that the movement was beginning to be taken seriously by Spain, and 7,000 soldiers were sent to Cuba to look after Spain's interests on the small island, Angel among them. But the once thriving world power of Spain was in a shaky place in the late 1890s, and when Spanish Prime Minister Canovas del Castillo was assassinated in 1897, the resulting confusion and unrest in the Spanish government gave the insurgents the open window they needed to take control of Cuba and, with the help of America, were finally able to push out Spain and deliver independence to Cuba. Well, not complete independence, as the American military did occupy the island for years after. In any case, many Spanish soldiers decided not to go back to Spain, but to make Cuba their new home, Angel Castro among them, which could be seen as an act of rebellion, opting not to return to the country he had been fighting for, and instead making a life among the insurgents who had taken Cuba away from Spain. Angel had taken a liking to the island and decided to try to make something of himself in Cuba, which he did. Ultimately, he would amass land and a near fortune. No one would ever say that my father was a millionaire, although he was very well to do and had a solid financial position, Fidel said. Although in that poor, suffering society, we children were treated like the children of rich people, and a lot of people would come up to us and be nice out of pure self-interest, although we never really realized that. The political events, still decades before Fidel's birth, were the building blocks of what came to define Fidel. His father's leaving Spain was just a start. Not having amassed much in his mother country, Angel built up his life in the next decade in Cuba. Within 10 years, he was a landowner, and in 1911, he married for the first time. When the marriage failed by the mid-1920s, he left his first wife and 5 children and took off with the family cook. This woman, Lina Ruz Gonzalez, originally from the Canary Islands, would give Angel an additional 7 children. Fidel was the 3rd born. While Angel and Lina started their life and family together in the 20s, they would not legally marry until 1943. Again, not exactly fitting with the mindset of the times. It seems Angel never planned to marry Lina, but the very Catholic Lina pushed for it. Once Angel's first marriage was officially and finally over, almost 20 years after he left his first wife, he no longer had a choice. So it would seem that Fidel's urge to rebel had come from both his father and his mother, who, even as a Catholic, had managed to have an illicit union and family for 20 years, and one could well imagine this was not how she had been raised. But while all sources indicate Fidel had a close relationship with his mother, his relationship with his father was at arm's length, Fidel said. Home represented authority, and that got my dander up, and the rebel spirit in me began to emerge. It has been reported that Fidel was somewhat rambunctious as a youth, which was what, in part, prompted his parents to send him off to boarding school. Why had Fidel given his parents such a hard time? I had several reasons for being a rebel, he said. Faced with certain Spanish authoritarianism, and even more so the particular Spaniard, his father, giving the orders. It was authority, respect in general. I didn't like authority, because at that time there was also a lot of corporal punishment, a slap on the head or a belt taken to you. We always ran the risk, even though we gradually learned to defend ourselves against it. So the early injustice Fidel experienced in his home was not at all about poverty, but about authority, another entity he would grow to rise against. The more educated he became, the more his rebellious streak began to turn into more of a defining trait. The push for education had come mostly from his mother. Lena came from nothing in every way, and she wanted her children to have everything she did not have. Education, even for Fidel's sisters, was a vital part of that plan. Fidel said, "My mother was practically illiterate, and, like my father, she learned to read and write practically on her own, with a great deal of effort and determination, too. I never heard her say that she'd gone to school. She was self-taught. An extraordinarily hard-working woman. There was nothing that escaped her attention." Fidel reported that his relationship with his mother was close, and that she was outwardly more loving and affectionate with the children, but she didn't spoil us, though. She was a stickler for order, savings, cleanliness. Nobody knew how she got the time and energy to do everything she did. She never sat down. I never saw her rest one second of the whole day. When the Spanish Civil War broke out in 1936, Fidel was just shy of 10 years old. At the time, he was home in Biran for a summer break, and he learned about the war by reading the newspapers to the cook, Manuel Garcia. Castro recalled. It had been a pro-Spanish newspaper since the War of Independence, and it was the most right-wing of any newspaper that ever existed in the country down to the triumph of the revolution. I would read it to Garcia for hours on end. So by age 10, Fidel was already starting to understand the difference between the establishment and the rebellion, between keeping the status quo and forging for progress, and the position of the nationalists, supported by the likes of Hitler and Mussolini, and the driving force behind the Spanish Republic, and he was already beginning to form his opinions. Seeds of ideas began to root and grow. He acquired the facts by reading the papers to Garcia, but then processed the information on his own. By this time, thanks to the corporal punishment at home and at school, Fidel had for years already begun to think against the establishment. I remember well those schoolhouse tortures, although they didn't happen every day or even all that often. They were really more just ways of scaring us. By that time, I was already very rebellious. I found myself needing to solve problems at a very early age, and that helped me acquire a sense of injustice. That sense of injustice became the filter through which he understood the events of the war and informed which side he chose. Even as a child, he began to act in a kind of violent manner against those whom he felt oppressed him. He recalled a time that one of his teachers got married and honeymooned in Niagara Falls. And this was all she talked about for what seemed like weeks to a room full of children who may or may not have had enough to eat that day, let alone any sense of what a luxury vacation was. Fidel recalled storming, the teacher's home. Our first act of vengeance, you might say revenge, and it was with a slingshot. We'd made slingshots out of a forked branch of a guava tree and some strips of rubber. There was a bakery nearby, and we took all the firewood for the oven and made ourselves a parapet, a fort. And we organized a bombardment that lasted like half an hour. Oh, we were vengeful little devils. When Fidel was around 11 years old, there was the incident involving his vice principal, which prompted his parents to pull him and his siblings out of school at Christmas. Fidel was incensed that his parents believed the school authorities over him, and he demanded to go back. "I won't accept you not letting me study," he told them. Still, it looked like they were not going to send them back. Fidel needed to give them incentive. "I said that if they didn't send me back to school, I was going to burn the house down," he says. I must have said it very seriously because I was determined to put up a fight against that injustice that was being done against me at school and at home. Suffice to say, Castro, along with his siblings, returned to school. In the years to come, those seeds of rebellion took root and sprouted into the man he would become. I faced certain problems even as a young child, and little by little I developed. That may indeed explain my role as a rebel. You hear people talk about rebels without a cause, but it seems to me, as I think back over it, I was a rebel with many causes, and I'm grateful to life that I've been able, throughout all these years, to continue to be one. Chapter 3. The Student Rebel. I was a dreadful, terrible example as a student, because I never went to classes. In high school, I never attended a lesson. At the university, I never went to class either. What I do was talk to the other students in the park, in the Patio de los Laureles. I just talk out there, there were small benches, with the guys and especially with the girls, because they paid a little more attention to me. They were better educated. There are always several students around listening while I explained my theories. It's funny that for as much as Fidel craved education, he was not an ideal student in any sense of the word. For him, school was about learning, but it was more about connecting. Even in high school, Fidel Castro was starting to find his wings, though in his case, it was the left wing he was finding, and finding it more and more attractive the more he learned and the older he got. Despite not being a stellar student, Castro was still a voracious learner and read countless books on his own, among them, the Communist Manifesto, the book that justified his ideas. He did have to go to class sometimes, however, so he didn't fail out of school. So when he needed to attend, he said, "I just let my imagination fly." As for his studies, he learned everything he needed to know to pass his classes by cramming the nights before exams. More significant to Fidel's destiny than what he would learn in the classroom was how he was growing politically. His discussions with other students in the courtyard while he avoided classes was only part of this. What I had was a rebellious spirit, hungry for ideas and knowledge, filled with curiosity and energy, he said. I sensed from a very young age that there were a great many things to do in my life. If he was testing his wings in high school, the guiding principles of his life would really begin to take shape in college. Castro started university in September 1945, with a deep sense of guilt that many who had grown up around him were never able to complete their education beyond sixth grade, even the best students. It was money that decided who would have the opportunity to continue their education, and thus, the opportunity to succeed. Even though Fidel came from money, and was one of the students who would be given the opportunity to succeed, he lamented. Was I better than any of those hundreds of poor kids in Biran, almost none of whom ever reached the sixth grade, and none of whom graduated high school, none of whom entered university? This sense of guilt was part of it. Another part of the equation, however, was his father's firm right-wing footing, and Fidel's need to rebel against the authoritarianism of his father at all costs. But his privilege made him an anomaly among his left-wing-oriented peers. The leftists saw me as a queer duck. They'd say, "Son of a landowner and a graduate of the Colegio de Belén, this guy must be the most reactionary person in the world." Reactionary or not, politics became the defining force in Fidel's life, and his dedication to it surpassed anything else he might be engaged in, including sports. Castro said, "I dedicated my life entirely to politics." He ran for student representative and won the election in a landslide, 181-33. Once ensconced in that world, he only wished to go further and further. Next was a run for the FEU, the University Student Federation. It was around this time that he started to imagine his place in the world of politics beyond the cocoon of college. And while at university, he opposed the government's candidate for federation president. The situation became dangerous and could have been deadly. Castro said, "I started to strongly oppose the government's candidate. That translated into countless dangers for me, because it ran counter to the interests of the mafia that dominated the university." The situation became so bad, he was practically shut out of school. "I couldn't enter any university facilities," he recalls. "I was up against all powers and all the impunities. They were armed and they had no scruples about killing. They had the support of all the police agencies and Grau's corrupt administration. The only thing that had contained them so far had been a moral force. The growing mass of students who supported me. No one had faced them openly in their feudal empire at the university, and they weren't going to tolerate any more defiance, any more challenges to their authority. They also had the university police on their side. I ran the real risk of being killed in what would be alleged to be intergroup rivalry. I cried, but I decided to go back. To go back to fight, even though I was aware that it might mean my death." Around this time, Castro's eyes were definitely also widening beyond the situation in Cuba, and he began to start to consider world politics, Cuba's place in the world, including its strengths, and what might be holding it back. In the late 1940s, he joined the Cayo Confites expedition. Here, he and like-minded students underwent military training to take down Dominican Republic dictator Rafael Trujillo. Trujillo, or as he was known, El Jefe, had been the leader of the Dominican Republic since 1930, and his nearly 30-year reign was considered one of the bloodiest in the history of the Dominican Republic. While the country prospered under his perceived tyranny, there were no civil liberties for anyone, and the wealth seemed only to go to Trujillo and a small circle of his family, friends, and other supporters. By this time, Fidel had been appointed chairman of the FEU's Committee for Dominican Democracy, and, Castro said, "I'd taken those responsibilities very seriously. I was convinced, on the basis of experience in Cuba, the Wars of Independence, and other analyses, that you could fight against a conventional modern army by using the methods of irregular warfare. My idea was a guerrilla struggle in the mountains of the Dominican Republic, instead of launching a badly trained, inexperienced force against Trujillo's regular army." While the attack on Trujillo was not exactly a success, the idea of fighting against a conventional modern army with irregular warfare became the foundation of so many other rebellions that Castro would soon lead. In April of 1948, when Colombian presidential candidate Jorge Eliezer Gaitan was shot to death outside of his office in Bogota, the poor of the city, whose interest the liberal candidate had at heart, began rioting, looting, and murdering in what would come to be known as El Bogotazo. 3,000 lives were lost in the chaos, and Bogota was destroyed. El Bogotazo affected Fidel deeply, especially as he had been a part of it. It showed him that when people were too far oppressed, when their only hope of freedom from that depression was murdered in the street, bad things would happen. El Bogotazo was an experience of great political importance, Castro recalled. Gaitan represented hope and development for Colombia. His death detonated an explosion, the uprising of the people, a people seeking justice. I joined the people. I grabbed a rifle in a police station that collapsed when it was rushed by a crowd. I witnessed the spectacle of a totally spontaneous popular revolution. The experience of El Bogotazo led me to identify myself even more with the cause of the people. If the attack on Trujillo and the chaos of El Bogotazo sparked Fidel's desire to unseat injustice in a kind of physical way, it was the Communist Manifesto that sparked his intellect. It made an enormous impact on me, he explained. I started to see and understand certain things, because I'd been born on a latifundio, which was, in addition, surrounded by other huge latifundios, and I knew what life was like for those people. I had the experience, at first hand, of what imperialism was domination. One government subservient to another government that was corrupt and repressive. While in college, Fidel married Mirta Diaz-Balart, who hailed from a wealthy Havana family. 1 year later, Fidel's son, Fidelito, was born. When Fidel graduated in 1950, armed now with knowledge and experience and an irrepressible passion to liberate the oppressed, he set up a law practice in Havana and began in earnest his political career. Chapter 4. Castro and Chibas. The telegraph operator's son was one of the first people to betray us when the struggle against Batista started. He was a compañero. He lived here in Havana. He was a friend, a supporter. He sympathized with us. He was in the party. I trusted him. That's the mistake. You shouldn't trust someone just because he's a friend.
Even in those early. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.